go like this. Initially, something about the embryological development of the anal canal, because that forms the basis of anatomy, nerve supply, blood supply, etc. And then anatomy of the anal canal and sphincters. And with this understanding, we should know how the defecation process or control of the defecation, that is continence, how these are physiologically we can achieve it. And in the end, a few practical points regarding how to assess the anal functions. What is the pressure? So that is about the anal manometry and rectal examination. A little information is added on that. So we shall discuss this. Over to Pavan.
Thank you, sir.
Pavan, you can start.
Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Pavan Kumar, first year DNB resident from Sagar Hospitals. Welcome to today's discussion over the anatomy of anal canal and physiology of sphincters. Let's have a brief discussion over the embryology of the anal canal. As we all know that during fourth week of intra-embryonic life, the primitive gut is derived from the endoderm, which is divided into foregut, midgut, and hindgut. So the proximal two-third of the anal canal is derived from the hindgut, which is of endodermal in origin. The distal one-third of the anal canal, which is ectodermal in origin, that is anal pit through our proctorium. So the pectinate line, which is the junction present between these two tissues of different origin, and it represents the watershed line. So normally, the cloacal membrane covering the anal canal disappears, and because of proliferation of the epithelial cells, the anorectal canal occluded. Recanalization of the anal canal is by the cellular apoptosis. Any incomplete in the recanalization results in the incomplete anal canal, incomplete imperforate anus. So the image in this slide shows the hindgut, which is derived from the endoderm, and the anal pit lined by the ectoderm. So anal canal, which is a terminal part of the large intestine, and it is around 3 to 4 centimeters in length, and it is situated in the perineal below the pelvic diaphragm, and it divides off sacculations, tenia coli, and the appendices epiploicae. It is surrounded by the external and the internal sphincters, which maintains the tone of the sphincters, helps in keep the anal canal enclosed. So the image in this slide shows the perineal region. It consists of urogenital triangle, and posteriorly it consists of anal triangle. And the anal canal, which begins at the anorectal junction, and it runs downwards and backwards and opens into the anal orifice, which is situated in the anal natal cleft, that is below and in front of the tip of coccyx. And the skin is surrounding this anal canal is pigmented, and it thrown into radiating folds due to subcutaneous muscle, corrugator, cutis, ani muscle. The anal canal anteriorly bounded by the perineal body and bulb of the penis in the case of the males, and in case of females, lower part of the vagina. The posteriorly, it is surrounded by the tip of the coccyx and the anococcygeal raphe and the fibrofatty tissue. The lateral boundary of this anal canal is formed by the ischiorectal fossa, which helps in allowing the anal canal expansion during defecation. So the interior of the anal canal is divided into upper part and the lower part of the anal canal by the pectinate line, which is the site for the attachment of the anal membrane. So the upper part is extending from the anorectal junction up to the pectinate line, and the lower part is extending from the pectinate line till the anal verge. So as the pectinate line, which is the junction of the two different tissues, which are different in their development, blood supply, lymphatic drainage, and nerve supply. So coming to the upper part of the anal canal, which consists of which is around 15 mm in length, and it consists of anal columns. These are the permanent longitudinal mucosal folds around 6 to 10 in number, and it contains radicles of superior rectal veins, and these are the anal walls, which is also called as walls of Morgagni. These are the crescentic folds of the mucous membrane connecting the lower part of the adjacent columns, and free margins of these walls are directed upwards. The position of these walls indicating the wavy pattern of the pectinate line, which is also known as dentate line. So anal sinuses, these are the vertical recesses between the anal columns and above the anal walls, and the ducts of the anal glands in the submucosa are opens into this floor of the anal sinuses. The lower part of the anal canal, which is divided into two regions, that is upper region and the lower region. The upper region is also called as pectin, and so upper region is also called as pectin, which is starting from the pectinate line till the Hilton's line, and which is around 15 mm in length, and it is lined by the non-keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. And in this area, that there is a mucus lining is appears bluish in color due to dense venous fluxes. The lower part of the lower region of the anal canal is around 8 mm in length, and it is lined by the true skin, which contains sweat glands and sebaceous gland, and it extending from the white line of Hilton to the anal orifice, which is having pigmentation with coarse hair. So the table in this
Pawan, one second.
Yes, sir.
There is a question in the chat box. Dr. Dayanand Nooli is asking, what is the difference between dentate line and pectinate line?
Sir, pectinate line and dentate line both are same, sir.
Same, yes. Okay. Any other questions? Any other questions from other PGs or staff? Any other? For other PGs, I have a question. What is the meaning of apoptosis? Initially, he used a term. Apoptosis, because initially there will be growth of the cells which is blocking the anal canal, and then because of the apoptosis, recanalization will occur. That's what he said. No, what is the meaning of apoptosis?
Programmed cell death, sir.
How it occurs? How they disappear means those cells which are blocking the canal, they disappear, resulting in recanalization. No? How it occurs?
Sir, cell shrinkage, sir, and forms a blebbing, and finally cell shrinkage and nuclear fragmentation and death of the cell, sir.
Yeah, there are so many proteolytic enzymes which are stored in the cell. They get released and almost like evaporation. They just disappear. So that results in recanalization. If there is defect in the recanalization, that will result in various anorectal malformations, agenesis, all those things. Any other questions from PGs? If nothing is there, I think one can continue.
Yes, sir. Okay. So the table in this slide shows the difference present between the upper part of the anal canal, that is above the pectinate line, and the lower part of the anal canal, that is below the pectinate line. So developmentally, above the pectinate line, which is derived from the endoderm of the hindgut, whereas below it is derived from the ectoderm of the proctodium, and above it is innervated by the autonomic nerves which are pain insensitive and for temperature. Whereas below the pectinate line, which is innervated by the somatic nerves, which are sensitive to pain and temperature. The lining epithelium above the pectinate line is simple columnar, and below this is stratified squamous epithelium. And the arterial supply for the above the pectinate line is superior rectal artery, and below it is inferior rectal artery. The venous drainage for the above pectinate line is superior rectal vein, which drains into the portal venous system, whereas below the pectinate line, which is drained by inferior rectal vein into the vena cava system. And lymphatic drainage above the pectinate line is drained by internal iliac lymph nodes, and below it is drained by superficial inguinal lymph nodes of horizontal set. And the hemorrhoids which is above the pectinate line are called as internal hemorrhoids, and below the pectinate line are called as external hemorrhoids.
So based on this slide, can you tell me why the pain is less in cases of stapled hemorrhoidectomy? It is conventionally described as less pain compared to conventional hemorrhoidectomy. Why is it so?
Sir, innervated by the somatic nerves, which are pain insensitive, sir.
Which one is innervated?
That lower part of the anal canal, sir.
Pawan,
yes, sir. Pawan,
question was.
Somatic nerve is never a pain. It is the pain sensitive area. Somatic nerves will always supply this. Autonomic nerves will supply the
insensitive. Yes, sir.
Insensitive area.
Autonomous nervous system is insensitive to pain. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
The stapled hemorrhoidectomy, the incision, the suture, what we take, it will be above the level of dentate line.
That point is pain
sensitive. Suture, what we take, yes, it is above the level of pectinate line, and cutting everything occurs above that level. That's why it is less painful compared to conventional hemorrhoidectomy, where incision, cutting, everything will be there in the sensitive somatic innervation area. That is important. Okay, continue.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Ravishankar has asked, what is the significance of portocaval anastomosis? Here. Where it occurs? Which line it occurs, this portocaval anastomosis in this area?
Sir, lower part of the anal canal, sir. Lower part of the anal canal.
No, it is the junction actually.
Junction.
Not lower part is the caval system, upper part is portal. So yes, portocaval means it should be somewhere where these two join.
Yes,
isn't
sir.
It?
Yes, sir.
Which are the other areas of portocaval anastomosis?
Sir, umbilicus and bare area of the liver, sir.
And more importantly?
Esophageal vessels.
Where end of these?
Gastroesophageal junction. So there varices occurs usually when portal hypertension is there. That's the importance.
No, but portocaval anastomosis in rectum or anal canal, any PGs can answer that question. What is the significance?
Sir, bleeding secondary to portal hypertension, sir.
Yes.
It can happen unusual.
Yeah. Okay, then what else?
Can be mistaken as hemorrhoids, sir, but
correct.
Yes, sir.
Correct. What else? Janani? Janani there? Sheena, can you answer that question? Madan Gopal? Nobody is answering the question. Okay, see, in younger, in patients who have hemorrhoids in the primary position, that is the 3, 7 and 11 o'clock, you usually, ascribe it to the primary hemorrhoids. If you see hemorrhoids in the non-primary positions, you have to be careful that this is not your usual hemorrhoids. It may be the portocaval anastomosis and portal hypertension. So whenever patients have hemorrhoidal bleeding, don't presume it is due to hemorrhoids. It most likely it may be, but if the patient is an alcoholic, if the patient, you know, a clinical examination shows there is a bit mild jaundice or any signs of liver failure or ascites, you should be wary that these hemorrhoids are due to the portal cavern anastomosis and portal hypertension. So don't, you know, be in a rush to operate on these patients because you can have torrential bleeding. So many of these cases, the treatment for hemorrhoids secondary to portal hypertension is not surgery, but control of portal hypertension. Okay, and band ligation if possible. So you have to be careful. Do not try to operate on these people. So that is the significance.
And another point is, if there is suppuration or infection in and around that area, it can go to portal circulation and develop into liver abscess.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Also important.
Portal pyemia. Portal pyemia can happen.
Pyemia, that can happen.
Yes.
Yeah. Continue.
So, the anal sphincter, that is external anal sphincter and the internal anal sphincter, which is present around the anal canal, which provides powerful sphincteric mechanism. So the internal anal sphincter, which is an involuntary muscle, and it starts where the rectum passes through the pelvic diaphragm and ends above the anal orifice. So the lower border of the...
Is it above the anal orifice or at the Hilton's line? Where it ends?
Ends above the anal, that is at the Hilton's line, sir.
Hilton's line, it doesn't extend up to the anal orifice.
Yes, sir.
It is at the Hilton's line because that line is because of that intersphincter groove.
Inter groove, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's important. So at the anal verge, you don't find the internal sphincter.
Yes, sir. The lower border of this internal sphincter is palpable at the intersphincteric groove, and subcutaneous external sphincter is medial fibers are present below it.
Yeah.
So it is continuous above with the circular muscle cords of the rectum, and below it reaches up to the Hilton's line, and it is surrounded by the superficial and deep external anal sphincter. And external sphincter, which is
an, you skipped a slide.
Sir, this slide explained in that image, sir, that intersphincteric groove, okay. And below it is a subcutaneous external sphincter, sir. Medial fibers are the subcutaneous external sphincter, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Continue.
And external sphincter, which is an voluntary sphincter, and it composed of skeletal muscles, and it is surrounds the whole length of the anal canal. So it forms the bulk of the anal sphincter complex, and it is divided by the lateral extensions from the longitudinal muscle layers, and it is attached anteriorly to the pubis. In the resting state, the anorectal tube is angulated forward at this level. Contraction of the puborectalis helps in increase this angle, and which is an important factor in maintaining continence. So the external sphincter is consists of three parts, that is the subcutaneous part, superficial part, the deep part. So the subcutaneous part, it lies below the internal sphincter, and it surrounds the lower part of the anal canal, and it has no bony attachments. It is derived from conjoint longitudinal cords traversed by the fibrous septa. And the superficial part of the anal canal in the external sphincter, which is elliptical in shape, and it is arises from the tip of the coccyx and anococcygeal raphe behind, and it is inserted into the perineal body in front, and it surrounds the lower part of the internal sphincter. So the deep part of the internal sphincter is surrounds the upper part of the internal sphincter, and the puborectalis muscle is blends with the deep part of the external anal sphincter, and forms a sling that is anorectal sling. So the anorectal sling, which is formed by the puborectalis muscle and the deeper part of the external anal sphincter and the internal sphincter, division of this anorectal sling results in rectal incontinence. So
which sphincter we are going to cut during the surgery for fissurectomy? Fissure in ano, we are going to do fissurectomy with sphincterotomy. No?
Sphincterotomy, sir.
What muscle is, which sphincter is cut in sphincterotomy?
Sir. Internal sphincter, sir.
Internal sphincter. Which part?
Sir, that lower part, sir. That is the
only lower part.
Yes, sir.
Up to where the fissure is extending.
Yes, sir.
To that, why it is cut?
So to relieve the spasm of the sphincter, sir.
Yeah, because spasm is one thing which is maintaining that fissure.
Yes, sir.
It will cause pain. So when you do sphincterotomy, that spasm goes up and also fissure will heal.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So the arterial supply of the anal canal. So the upper part of the anal canal is supplied by the superior rectal artery, which is a continuation of the inferior mesenteric artery, and the lower part of the anal canal is supplied by the inferior rectal artery, which is a continuation, which is a branch of pudendal artery.
Internal pudendal.
Internal pudendal artery.
Yeah. And what about that middle one? There is a middle rectal artery also.
Yes, sir. It contributes a little contribution, sir.
In between.
In between, sir.
And Dr. Nooli is asking, how do you identify internal sphincter and external sphincter on the table while doing surgery? We were talking about the sphincterotomy, no?
Yes, sir.
For fissure in ano.
Yes, sir.
How do you identify that internal sphincter?
To cut? Sir, internal sphincter, sir, it consists of continuation circular muscle fibers, no, sir.
No, that is right. While doing surgery, before cutting, you should identify it, no?
Yes, sir.
How do you confirm this is the internal sphincter? How do you identify?
Sir, by digital examination, that rectal examination, we palpate that intersphincteric groove, sir. Above that is that end of the internal sphincter.
Any other PGs who have done surgery or assisted? Other PGs, senior PGs?
That whitish, you can see in that internal sphincter, sir.
No. Before cutting, you must dissect it, no?
Yes, sir.
It is not directly visible. Something is covering it. A mucosa or skin, it is covering. So how do you identify? Where do you dissect? Where do you make incision? Before cutting, you must identify it, no? That's what Dr. Nooli is asking. This is very practical point. Because this is what useful for surgery based on your anatomy knowledge. That's what you have to know. See, you are going to put two ribbon retractors anteriorly and posteriorly at 6 o'clock and 12 o'clock position and pull it. And if you feel laterally at 3 o'clock position, you can feel it like a taut string-like. So at the Hilton's line, if you make a small transverse incision and you can dissect superficial and deep to this taut sphincter, that is between the mucosa and the sphincter, and intersphincter, between the internal sphincter and external sphincter, then that's how you are going to separate it, and you can feel it like a taut string when you give traction anteriorly and posteriorly at 6 o'clock and 12 o'clock position. And once you identify, you put the two blades in this plane and you can cut it. I think that explains Dr. Nooli's question. Dr. Nooli, sir, is it okay? Or anything you want to add? Hello?
Dr. Ramakrishna?
Yes, sir.
I think what Hari said is also correct. The color and the external sphincter is more red and fleshy. Internal sphincter is fibers are circular and also more of whitish.
That is correct, sir. But what I'm telling is, while doing surgery, probably we may not be able to see all those things because we are going to make very small incision there. And most of it is just by feeling it. I don't think we will be able to see those color.
So what we usually do is put an anal speculum. So when you put the anal speculum and stretch it, then when you make an incision on the mucocutaneous junction, and then gently dissect it, you can feel the internal sphincter as a circular, tight, as Dr. Ramakrishna described, a taut band. And that you have to cut about 1/3 to half up to the, you have to see where the dentate line is. You should never go up to the dentate line. It should only cut maybe about maximum of half of that. So that will, give you a good internal sphincterotomy. I think that you are right. It's mainly felt rather than seen. But when Dr. Shivaram says, well, for example, for whatever reason you are dissecting in that area, if you make a bigger incision, then you can see the external sphincter to be reddish and internal sphincter to be pale pink.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, pale pink.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Okay, continue, Paul.
Yes, sir. So the venous drainage of the upper part of the anal canal is derived by the superior rectal drained by superior rectal veins, which drains into the portal venous system, and the lower part of the anal canal is drained by inferior rectal veins, which drains into the inferior vena cava. So they communicate with the rectal veins at 3 o'clock, 7 o'clock, and 11 o'clock positions, which is the site of portosystemic anastomosis. The nerve supply of the anal canal, that is external sphincter and the internal sphincter. The internal sphincter is a smooth muscle which is supplied by autonomic nervous system, that is sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve supply. And the external anal sphincter is, which is a striated muscle, and it is supplied by the somatic nerve, that is inferior rectal nerve and the peripheral branch of the pudendal nerve. And because of the external anal sphincter, voluntary control of the defecation is possible. And the lymphatic drainage of the upper part of the anal canal is by the internal iliac nodes, and the lower part of the anal canal is drained by the superficial inguinal lymph nodes of horizontal set.
So till now anatomy is discussed. Any questions or doubts from the TGs so far, or comments?
TGs, can you tell me the mechanism of continence? How is the continence maintained? How much does the internal sphincter and how much does the external sphincter contribute?
Sir, the internal anal sphincter is a major contributor, sir, of high pressure zone. And main control is, like Pawan said, sir, the puborectal sling face main part, sir, and voluntary control, external sphincter also, sir. Mostly 80 to 90% of internal sphincter.
Yeah, the resting anal sphincter tone, which, for example, provides the majority of the continence. But even when you are asleep, the continence is maintained because of the resting anal sphincter tone. And in emergency situations or when you are in meeting and other places where it is, important for you to maintain your continence, then the external sphincter comes into play and then allows you to remain continent. So I think that is about 90-10 is the correct answer. Sometimes it can stretch to 80-20 also.
Okay, sir.
Okay, continue.
So, distension of the rectum with the feces initiates the reflex contraction of its musculature. And as I discussed in the earlier slides, that internal sphincter is supplied by autonomic nervous system, that is sympathetic nerve supply, which is excitatory, and the parasympathetic supply, which is inhibitory. Whereas the external anal sphincter which is supplied by somatic nerve, that is internal pudendal nerve, and the state of tonic state of sphincter helps in contraction of the anus and keep the anus in closed. And moderate distension of the rectum increases the force of its contraction. So the first urge to defecate occurs when there is a rectal pressure around 18 mm of Hg, and when external pressure reaches around 55 mm of Hg, both external anal sphincter and the internal anal sphincter relaxes, which causes the expulsion of the contents of the rectum, which causes defecation. That external anal sphincter helps in voluntary defecation and can be initiated by straining.
You know, straining is not through the external sphincter. Straining because of the abdominal muscles contracts, which increases the intra-abdominal pressure. This external sphincter is going to relax during defecation. It doesn't contract.
So the angle becomes wider. So the rectum becomes straighter.
Straighter. Yes.
The inner rectal angle becomes straighter and hence allows the passage.
That is because of the relaxation of the puborectalis.
So normally the angle present between the anus and the rectum is approximately 90 degrees, and the contraction of the puborectalis muscle inhibits the defecation. For continence to be maintained, the anorectal angle should be less than 90 degrees. So the continence is maintained by the contraction of the external anal sphincter, internal anal sphincter. Contraction of the puborectalis muscle produces anorectal angulation, in this which through the contraction of all these muscles we can maintain the continence. So during defecation, when there is a sensation of stools in the rectum, the external anal sphincter, internal anal sphincter, and the puborectalis muscle relaxes, and the contraction of the rectum and the abdominal muscles causes expulsion of the stools. So this is the correct position, that is defecation while defecation, that is the squatting posture. That is, the both the legs are over the stool, and we have to lean forward so that the puborectalis muscle relaxes and makes the straightens the pathway to the anus. So, as a defecation is a spinal reflex which is voluntarily inhibited by the contraction of the external anal sphincter and facilitated by relaxing the sphincter and contracting the abdominal muscles. So gastrocolic reflex is a normal reflex which is usually when the distension of the stomach by the food, which causes initiates the contraction of the rectum that leads to frequently desire to defecate. That is when this is a usually reflex when it is more aggravated, then which leads to frequent desire to pass in stools. So
Pavan, you have not explained that properly.
Yes, sir.
In patients who have hyperacidity, patients who have excessive gastrin secretion, that causes it's a gastrocolic reflex, which means as soon as you eat something, you have a urge to pass motion. So that is one of the findings in the history, which gives you a clue that the patient is probably suffering from hyperacidity. Okay. So that is another thing that for example, apart from asking for all the usual things that you ask, if you ask for gastrocolic reflex, and so many times patients themselves volunteer this information, this indicates hyperacidity. So that is called gastrocolic reflex. Okay.
There is a question by Dr. Hari. What is rectoanal inhibitor reflex?
I think Hari, he will describe that in the anorectal manometry.
Okay, sir.
The sphincter contracts when the fecal matter enters the rectum and prevents the leakage. If the sphincters are weak, that leads to fecal incontinence. Similarly, if the sphincters are more contracted and in a state of spasm like this, it leads to constipation. So the basic requirement for the control of defecation is that is the rectum, which acts as a reservoir with adequate capacity, and the sphincter, that is both external and the internal sphincter, which generate adequate pressure, the normal sensations, and the coordinating system between the brain and the nervous system. So the discussion with the knowledge of above discussed anatomy and physiology, these are the routine cases which we are clinically seen, like anal fissure, which is a longitudinal split in the anoderm of the distal anal canal, and it extends from the anal verge proximally towards dentate line, but not beyond the dentate line. Similarly, hemorrhoids, these are the normal anatomical questions. As I discussed, this is the portocaval anastomosis communicated at the 3 o'clock, 7 o'clock, and the 11 o'clock position, when they become engorged and protruded, and they presented as the internal hemorrhoids.
No. Don't give wrong information. See, the portocaval anastomosis has got nothing to do with the primary anal cushions. The anorectal cushions, they are all, and they are called primary because that is where the arteriovenous anastomosis happens. It has got nothing to do with portocaval anastomosis. No, portocaval anastomosis happens all round. So that is what I told you. Whenever there is primary hemorrhoids, you will see that in the 3, 7 and 11 o'clock position. When you have portocaval, portal hypertension leading to hemorrhoids, you will see it all round, or you will see it in unusual positions. So that is one thing that gives you a clue that this is not your usual standard hemorrhoids, but it is probably likely to be due to portal hypertension. So don't mislead people. Okay.
Sorry, sir.
So these anal cushions are arteriovenous. So that is why the hemorrhoidal bleeding is more arterial than venous bleeding, because they are arteriovenous anastomosis.
Yeah, there is a question by Dr. Nooli. What is your experience regarding Doppler guided hemorrhoidal artery ligation? Dr. Ravishankar or Dr. Shivaram sir can answer this. Do you have any experience?
Shivaram sir. Are you there, Dr. Shivaram? So probably he's not there. I have no personal experience with the Doppler guided S1, but I have seen people doing it. In the short term, I think it's effective. I don't know how good it is in the long term. I think long term results are not very successful, which is why it is not caught on as one of the premium modalities for treatment of hemorrhoids. If the treatment of hemorrhoids is now mainly conservative and rubber band ligation, if that doesn't work, either open hemorrhoidectomy if they are grade 3 and grade 4 with significant external component, or stapled hemorrhoidectomy if there is significant internal component. Nowadays, the laser hemorrhoidectomy is coming in, which I think in the short term again is pretty good, but long term results are awaited. That is my take as far as hemorrhoids are concerned. Ramakrishna sir?
I also don't have any experience, sir. We always do either open or stapled hemorrhoidectomy.
Dr. Nooli, sir, what is your experience, sir?
No, sir. I just wanted to ask you, since you have witnessed the surgery, do they really, see the pulsations, sir, through the Doppler? Because these locations of these arteries might be variable. That's why I'm asking.
See, the thing is, it comes with experience, but the people who do that regularly seem to pick it up and ligated. I am not sure whether you know, whether they're absolutely certain, because the long-term results are not that good, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, continue.
So the clinical examination of the clinical rectal examination, so which consists of both inspection and palpation, and these are the various positions during rectal examination, that is lateral, left lateral position, jockey position, and the lithotomy position. So coming to inspection, so it provides the clues in many disorders, like in case of hemorrhoids, skin tags, and in case in patients with inflammatory bowel disease, fistula tracts and fissures, and superficial ulcers caused by herpes simplex or syphilis, and the perianal skin may be affected in generalized disorders like psoriasis, vitiligo, syphilitic dermatitis, and candidiasis.
Dr. Pawan,
yes, sir.
There is a question. Why is it called lithotomy position? What does it mean? Lithotomy position you showed, no? Initially,
yes, sir.
One of these slides. What does it mean? What is the meaning of that? Why is it called lithotomy? Litho means what? Pyrolithotomy. Nephrolithotomy. You have heard that, no? Any other PGs know that? Why is it called lithotomy position? I thought everyone knows, so we took it for granted. After nobody asked it, it's very nice. See, the previous days, these urethral calculus, they used to remove those stones, urethral calculus, by putting the patient in this position. That's why it is known as lithotomy position. Dr. Noli, sir, is it right or anything you want to add?
No, sir. It is through previously in the through the rectal route, they used to remove the bladder stones. Okay. It was so much havoc. They were not knowing it will lead to infection, this, that. But big vesicle stones were removed through the rectal route. But the patient went into septicemic shock and all those things were with. That's how was the history tells. Later they realized and it stopped. But that is the position used to they go for removing the big vesicle stones. Through rectum they used to remove. So the position was this position.
Okay. I thought it is urethral calculus. Okay.
No, vesicle calculus.
Right. Okay, continue.
So, during palpation, the sensations around the perianal region can be tested by scratching each side of the buttock, and the motor to know the contraction states of the muscle by the pararectal examination. We ask the patient to act like if to stop midstream urine, and feels the contraction of the puborectalis and the sphincter, and ask the patient to relax. So you can feel the relaxation of the sphincters around the anal canal. And through rectal examination, we can feel up to 7 to 8 centimeters height. So what I explained in the inspection and palpation, that is explained here, sir, in the below slide. And so in the case of patients who have fecal incontinence because of the weak sphincter muscles and all, there are some, so pelvic floor rehabilitation is the first line of treatment, which includes bowel management education and retraining, and the pelvic floor muscle training, which is also known as Kegels exercises, and biofeedback therapy, use of electrical stimulation and manual myofascial release, and connective tissue mobilization techniques. So anorectal manometry which is also called as anal manometry. It is an important diagnostic tool in the case of to assess the fecal incontinence and in case of chronic constipating patients. So in this technique, we use a small balloon and in the rectum to distend the rectum and looks for the strength of the anal sphincters and the sensation of the stools in the rectum and the reflexes that gowns the bowel and movement of the rectum and the anal muscles. So the complete anorectal manometry includes anal sphincter electromyography and anorectal test and squeezing profile, squeezing pressure profiling and rectal volume measurement and anorectal inhibitory reflex measurement and balloon expulsion test. So the image in this slide shows that anorectal stationary state and squeezing pressure. In this, the patient is in semi-recumbent position and we can able to assess the different pressures at the anterior, posterior, right and left in the resting position and also on the squeezing pressures. Squeezing pressures. So these are the various ano physiological testings like pudendal nerve, motor terminal latency test and manometry, resting squeezing pressures and their knowledge and their normal values and interpretations and indications as shown in the below slide.
No, go back.
Yes, sir.
Can't stop. We can't do this very quickly like that. You should talk about what is the resting anal sphincter pressure, what is the squeeze pressure, when is the rectal anal inhibitory reflex, when does it happen, what is the volume, when will you start getting the contractions, all these things you should mention. What is the significance of this the inner rectal manometry?
Sir.
What is the significance?
Sir,
Hari, I think it is probably not your question. I think some seniors should answer that. Is Ajit and Saurav there or they are not there today?
Not there, I think, sir.
Exams, okay. Hari, do you know what is anal rectal manometry? Why do you do it? When do we do it?
Sir, it is it measures the pressure, sir, mainly, sir. Maximum resting anal pressure. Or sphincter pressure to analyze the defect problem, what is the reason, and along with it, if like Pawan said, the electromyography study which shows the muscle function, how the electrical impulses are created, so it helps in assessing the sphincter tone mainly, sir, and also the reflexes, how it is functioning, what is the reason for the incontinence. Or else any idiopathic incontinence, there are incontinence secondary to any neurological disorders, we can differentiate, sir.
See, the importance of anorectal manometry is manifold. The main thing is the you should know what is the, you know, it is usually using, you know, used using this catheter, which is usually has water columns, and nowadays the newer manometry is different. Previously, it used to come with water columns, and you could assess the sphincter pressure as a total thing. And also, if you could, also see whether there is any defect in the internal sphincter in any area. You could determine the resting anal sphincter pressure. You could, you know, measure the squeeze pressure and see whether there is any difference. For example, even somebody with a reasonably good resting pressure but could not have a good squeeze pressure, indicating mainly an external component which is not working, you know, and so that is, you know, a good clue. And then assess whether there is a rectal anal inhibitory reflex that is present, because if that is not absent, that again indicates a problem. That is, either it could be what is called as anismus, where the rectal anal inhibitory reflex is very strong, or lack of it will indicate incontinence. Because whenever the rectum contracts, the anal canal has to relax. So that is the significance of rectal anal inhibitory reflex. So if this is not present, what happens is, if if the rectum contracts and the anal canal also contracts, then it leads to what is condition called anismus. So where the sphincter very tight, and these people have a condition called obstructed defecation. So that is the significance of rectal anal inhibitory reflex. Again, if the rectum relaxes and the anal canal contracts, again, the problem is that the patient is unable to defecate properly. So that is the significance of, you yourself asked that question. And then you should know when is the squeeze pressure, what is the first, when you get the first sensation and when the patient is ready to defecate. So all of these things in conjunction with the, what you call as defecating proctogram, will give you a good view of the entire defecation process, the neuromuscular control, and presence of what we call as the descending perineal syndrome, presence of solitary rectal ulcer syndrome, presence of partial collapse, prolapse, or complete prolapse. So all of these conditions, and rectocele. So all of these conditions can be assessed comprehensively using anorectal manometry and defecating proctogram, and in some situations using the electromyography, that is the pudendal nerve motor terminal latency. That is a very significant thing. All the significance of all these things is in patients who have had what so-called normal labor, especially women, they can have, you know, a undetected the tears, which could later, you know, cause incontinence initially. Sometimes, even if they have not had a proper tear also, it is said that patients who have this defecation with the obstructed labor for a significant period of time, they undergo what is called as a immunogenic damage to the vasa nervorum of the pudendal nerves. So later in life, they will develop incontinence. So there is a lot of these things which you should understand. Especially in women who come with fissures, you have to be very careful, because women's, the sphincter length is shorter compared to men. The sphincter tone is less compared to men. So you should not offer sphincterotomy in women without a proper assessment. In Western countries, they say without anorectal manometry, you should never do a sphincterotomy in women. But in India, we probably don't have the facility to do that. So hence, you have to be extremely careful in offering sphincterotomy in women. So these are the significance of anorectal manometry. Ramakrishna sir, you want to add anything?
Yeah, I think he has presented well. And if any further questions are there from PGs or staff, we can take up.
Noli sir, what is your experience of anorectal manometry, sir?
Sir, I just want to know from you only. Routinely, when would you like to advocate this anorectal, sir?
Sir, I think when patients come to you with the incontinence, that is when you mainly do anorectal manometry. So if the patient presents to you, you do a Wexner score and see how bad the incontinence is. And then I think rectal examination is almost halfway there as far as anorectal manometry is concerned, because as you know very well, you are a great master in rectal examination, but it will tell you everything that you need to know. But for you to confirm it, anorectal manometry will help. And then you plan the treatment accordingly. If the patient also complains of obstructed defecation, where there is significant difficulty in passing motions, again, when you do a rectal examination, you will find a very tight anal sphincter, and the patient will not be able to relax when you ask him to relax, or him or her to relax. So that again shows that there is significance, the overactivity of the rectal anal inhibitory reflex. So you have to, again, anorectal manometry is useful in that. And in patients who've had trauma, neurogenic conditions, and rectal prolapse, again, for rectal prolapse, for you to assess the current level of incontinence, and then post-operatively, after you have done the surgery, whether the continence course improves. So again, apart from doing the Wexner scores, you can also use the anorectal manometry as a objective tool to assess how good the incontinence, how bad the incontinence was before surgery, and how well it has improved post-surgery. So that is another advantage of anorectal manometry. And then, as I said, in women who come with painful, difficult fissures, and if clinically you feel the sphincter tone is high, then you can probably, because anorectal manometry is not easily available, you can take a chance and do the sphincterotomy, or you can offer them conservative treatment. And if they continue to come back with recurrent, say, fissures or painful fissures, which is not refractory to medical management, then if the sphincter tone is high, you can do a sphincterotomy. Otherwise, in women where there is low tone, but yet fissures in ano, you should never do a sphincterotomy in such patients. So you can then use the anorectal manometry. So these are the several uses of anorectal manometry as far as I know.
Sir, routinely, means some patients, they complain of incontinence after the surgery. Okay. Will it be helpful in those patients?
Of course, definitely, because after surgery, especially after hemorrhoidectomy, if the patients have become incontinent, or after sphincterotomy, if they have become incontinent, you treat them conservatively, and if they continue to remain asymptomatic, then you do an anorectal manometry and also transrectal ultrasound. So, but leave that for a period of time, because you want to know whether there is defect in the internal sphincter. And if there is defect in the internal sphincter, has the fibrosis already set in? So these information can be gleaned by using combination of anorectal manometry, which will tell you where the sphincter is defective, and the transrectal ultrasound will give you the pictorial depiction of where the sphincter is defective. And then later, if you feel the patient continues to remain asymptomatic, and if there is fibrosis of the ends of the sphincter which they are cut, then you can suture it, which has a 50 to 60, 70% success rate, but it is better than doing nothing. So that is when you can use a anorectal manometry and transrectal ultrasound.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
There is a question. Is defecography and defecating proctogram, are they same?
Yes, they are both the same.
Same. Two words for the same procedure. Any other questions, sir? And comments from seniors, Dr. Shivaram is there?